Okay, let's begin. Good morning to all of you again. So I have two sessions where we'll take up elements of optics. So I'm not going to actually do things like calculation of the fringe width of Young's double slit experiment or diffraction pattern. Those things have been done for years, and I'm sure you know better about the derivations than I do. So what I will try to do is somewhat general. In some sense, it is good that we had a session on electromagnetism, because the optics is basically built on electromagnetism. And light, as you know, is an electromagnetic wave. So therefore, propagation of light and all phenomena connected with light are also related to whatever we have learned about the electromagnetic field. I'll be talking about the light propagation, in particular, the vector nature of light. We have seen that because of the fact that the electromagnetic field, so E and H or B, are vectors or vector fields, the principle of superposition holds. It is the principle of superposition which is at the heart of our discussion connected with interference and diffraction. I will really not distinguish between them, because the difference, if at all they exist, is essentially in the phenomena that they describe, but both of them are different manifestations of principle of superposition of the vector nature of light. Later on, I'll be, not in this session, I'll be talking about light amplifications and some basic characteristics of optical fibers. And let us see how much time we have. So in this session, I plan to essentially talk about some things which could have been done in the electromagnetic theory itself, provided we had a little more time. But it's a good idea to have done those things earlier so that we can review it again. So firstly, there is some, you notice that yesterday I told you the physicists don't like the auxiliary fields like H and D, but it turns out that the people who do optics, they are quite happy with using E and H. And since most of the time they deal with linear media, linear non-magnetic media, they don't really have that much of difference to worry about the B and H, in which case why keep an extra mu zero? So therefore they just always work with E, yes, but with H. So with those modifications, the Maxwell's equation that we have, this is the Faraday's law equation, del cross of E was minus dB by dt. Since B is mu zero H, so I get del cross of E. I'm talking about light propagation vacuum. So del cross of E becomes minus mu zero dH by dt. The corresponding Ampere-Maxwell's relation, which was del cross B equal to epsilon zero mu zero dE by dt, plus a source term. But because I am working in vacuum, I don't have any sources. So therefore, this equation becomes del cross of H equal to epsilon 0 dE by dt. Remember that it was del cross of H was equal to dD by dt. Now, if I have a source-free region, by source-free region, I mean the region in which I don't have currents or charges, in which I am looking at the electromagnetic field. The sources could be somewhere else, but the region in which I am looking at, if they are source-free region, then my del dot of E, which should have been rho by epsilon 0, is equal to 0. And del dot of B, which is equal to mu 0 times del dot of H, which is equal to 0, which means the divergence of the magnetic field, as always, is equal to 0. So I could take these two equations and do a del cross of that. So my del cross of E was minus mu 0 dH by dt. So if I do del cross of E, I get this equation. And so that quantity is equal to minus mu 0 epsilon 0 d square E by dt square, because of del cross of H becoming equal to E. There is a standard vector expression for the curl of curl. This you must have worked out several times. It says that the del cross of E is del of del dot of E minus del square E. This is derived in an elementary vector algebra book. Now, if you substitute this relationship there, along with the fact that your del dot of E is equal to 0, substitute this here, you get an equation which you called yesterday as the wave equation. Namely, del square of E is mu 0 epsilon 0, which is nothing but 1 over C square times d square h by dt square, where C is 1 over square root of mu 0 epsilon 0. If you put in the numbers here, it works out to 3 into 10 to the power 8, but this is rigorously correct, irrespective of what the values of mu 0 and epsilon 0 are. So let us look at a linear isotropic media. So what we did was to say that my wave equation is del square of E is 1 over C square d square E by dt square. C is the velocity of light. And now, since both these equations are identical or similar, their solutions will be very similar. So let us do this. Let us define a small u to represent 1 over square root of mu epsilon. Now, I said that I am dealing with linear isotropic media, which means that the medium is may have a dielectric constant, but then dielectric constant is simply a permittivity of that medium, epsilon, is simply a constant times the permittivity of free space, and where this k is called the relative permittivity, also known as dielectric constant. To realize that we are dealing with dielectric constant and not a general dielectric function, because in solids, the relationship between E and D could be a lot more complicated, and so therefore, and they could be dependent on many other things, direct isotropy, they could be anisotropic and things like that. And so therefore, what we say is that I am dealing with linear isotropic. Linear, of course, means the relationship is just a proportionality constant. Isotropy means the dielectric constant doesn't vary from direction to direction. And likewise, I define something called a relative permeability, which is the ratio of the permeability of the medium to mu zero. And that is, incidentally, though I have formally defined it, the medium that we always will deal with will be non-magnetic. So as a result, this relative permeability factor is equal to 1. So my velocity u can be expressed as, this was 1 over square root of mu epsilon, and if you substitute these, it becomes c times square root of under root of 1 over square root of k times km, and these out of that I said that I will take km to be equal to 1. So as a result, what I get is that my refractive index of the medium. Now remember, everything is constant here now. I am not saying things change. I am not dealing with dispersion, which arises because of the fact that the refractive index could depend upon the frequency. All those I am ignoring right now. And I am saying that the ratio of the velocity of light in vacuum to the velocity in the medium, which I have represented by u, that is given by square root of k into km. And most optical media are non-magnetic, so therefore this is simply equal to square root of k. And one always takes for non-magnetic medium square root of the relative permittivity to be the same as the index of refraction. So I am not dealing with any functional dependence, no dependence on frequencies and things like that. So therefore, we had seen that each component of E or H, which I have now represented by a capital U, will satisfy this equation. I have written it in Cartesian coordinate. This satisfies this equation. And there are harmonic solutions to these equations. You can simply substitute them and find out that the equations are satisfied. The form is U0 cosine or sine, it is unimportant because all that it means is a phase difference between them, times, this is a three-dimensional wave equation, cosine of k dot r minus omega t, okay, where this vector k is I times kx plus j times ky plus k times kz is what is known as a propagation vector, the propagation vector whose magnitude is known as the wave number. So this is our starting point of discussion. What we are now saying is that I have an electric field or a magnetic field, so I will be using the word electromagnetic field, which has a solution in vacuum or in isotropic linear medium as a term which is amplitude, which is constant, times a cosine function, and the argument of the cosine function is k dot r minus omega t. So therefore, if I am looking at how this field is behaves with space and time, so obviously there is a space dependence and there is also a time dependence. However, if you look at the surface which is determined by at a particular time, for instance, if you look at that k dot r minus omega t is constant. Now, which means if you fix t at a given time, then you get an equation which says k dot r equal to constant. If time is fixed, omega of course is the radian frequency which is also fixed. So, k dot r equal to constant, which is nothing but equation to a plane. So, therefore, what you are saying is this, that if you take constant values of the argument of cosine, now they define at a particular time a plane. But if you now look at that plane at subsequent times, which means that as time keeps on changing, this surface also keeps on moving. Because the value of that constant, that I am talking about k dot r minus omega t equal to constant. So if I take one particular time, I get k dot r equal to one constant. If I take another time, k dot r equal to another constant. So with time, what is happening is these surfaces, they are moving. And what is the property of that surface? It means that the phase of this cosine function given by k dot r minus omega t, it is constant at a particular time. And if I am now, incidentally, surfaces of constant phases are known as wave fronts. So these wave fronts, they propagate with time. So therefore, I look at, I have a direction of propagation, and this k by definition, remember your school coordinate geometries, k n dot r equal to constant is equation to a plane, and the vector n is actually perpendicular to r in that case. So therefore, what happens in such a case is that we are saying there is a direction k, and the surface of constant phase is essentially a plane perpendicular to that at any given time. This plane which is perpendicular to it keeps on moving with t because that constant keeps on shifting. So this is what we are talking about. This entire argument is what I am calling as a phase, and this phase of term of course changes with time. So this is a pictorial representation of what happens, that by virtue of that equation that k dot r equal to constant, n dot r equal to constant represents a plane, I have a sequence of planes. Okay, here what you are seeing is a part of the surfaces, and this is obviously the direction of the k vector. And the surfaces are normal to it by definition, because I have said k dot r equal to constant, and that is an equation to a straight line, equation to a plane with the direction of k being normal to the surfaces. All right. Now, this is fine, excepting that when you deal with cosine and sine functions, life becomes a little more complicated. It becomes complicated because when you differentiate a sine function, it becomes a cosine function. When you differentiate a cosine function, it becomes a sine function and things like that. Mathematically, it is much more prudent, instead of looking at solutions in terms of cosine and sine functions, to represent them by a complex function. Now you would say, what is a complex wave? There is nothing like a complex wave. So I can say, my solution is actually a real part or imaginary part of this quantity. So I don't really worry about which part I take. I do all my mathematical calculation using the form e to the power I k dot r minus omega. And since exponential functions have this attractive features, that differentiation of exponential function gives us the exponential function back, the mathematics becomes much easier. And at the end of your calculation, when you are ready to calculate physical quantities, then what you do is to take real part, alternatively multiply your solution with its complex conjugate and take a square root. This is a mathematical technique. It has nothing to do with the what actually is going to happen. Now, so therefore, we are dealing at this moment with plane waves, The phrase plane wave means, you remember I talked about surfaces of constant phase or wave fronts. Now, if the surfaces of constant phase happen to be planes, we call them plane waves. And these are essentially the solution, plane wave solutions. Now, point is this, that you would then say that what happens in three dimension? You know that I will have a similar equation in three dimension, which the way I have done in either quantum mechanics or other things which we discussed, I will be able to separate the solutions and then write down a wave equation in terms of the distance r. Now it turns out, you would normally say that if cosine k dot r minus omega t is a solution of the Cartesian form of the wave function, then I expect cosine kr minus omega t, okay, not k dot r, I'm talking about r as a distance, kr minus omega t would be the corresponding solution. Now you see, there is no problem in saying that if I look at functions like cosine kr minus omega t, these things obviously have constant values of the phase at a given time t when I take surfaces of constant radius. Now if r is constant, which is the radius, then these are spheres. Now, so therefore my wave fronts become spheres. Now that is not a problem. The problem is, if you write down cosine kr minus omega t, this is not a solution of a wave equation. You can go back to your radial wave equation and try to see what happens if cosine k dot r minus omega t is a solution of the three-dimensional wave equation. But if you are looking at just the radial wave equation, then your expectation is cosine kr minus omega t would be a solution, but it turns out cosine kr minus omega t is not a solution of the wave equation. However, it turns out that instead of taking cosine kr minus omega t, if you take 1 over r times cosine kr minus omega t, that will be a solution of the spherical wave equation. Now, this is an important point because it tells you that the amplitude of this wave, you see, in this case, which was a plane wave, the amplitudes are constant. But if you are taking spherical waves, the amplitudes have to depend upon r as 1 over r. And that is the origin of the inverse square law of intensity of light. That is, if you take the flux through a surface of radius r, then as you proceed with distance, because of the fact that the surface area of the sphere is proportional to 4 pi r square, and if the flux is to remain the same electromagnetic energy is coming out through a larger and larger sphere, it says that my intensity must fall as 1 over r square. That's the standard inverse square law for the intensity. So let us look at the propagation of plane waves. So my equation, as I said, this capital U stands for either electric field or magnetic field. In optics, the fancy of the people is to look at the electric field strengths for the simple reason it has a much larger magnitude than the corresponding magnetic field strength. And so therefore, what we do is look at this equation with 1 over small u square is the u, small u is the velocity of light, and we have plane wave solutions of this form, u0 e to the power I k dot r minus omega t. Now this is actually a very attractive way of writing it. If you look at this form, that u is equal to u0 into e to the power I k dot minus r minus omega t, and you apply a del operator on it, that is you are differentiating it with respect to space, all that it does is to multiply this function with an ik. Now notice that this feature will not be there if I had taken a cosine function or a sine function. Cosine functions will become sine function and vice versa. So here what will happen is that if I take a del operator, the effect of applying a del operator on u is to multiply this u with I vector k. Now, likewise, if you are to take a time differentiation d by dt, then the effect of the time derivative is to multiply your solution by minus I omega. So for this situation, I have a nice prescription. And the prescription is that when you have to put a del operator, del cross, del dot, whatever you feel like. So you simply multiply your solution with ik. If you have to differentiate with respect to time, multiply your solution with minus I omega. And this happens because I have chosen complex functions. So therefore, you look at this equation, del cross of E equal to minus mu dH by dt. This is our Faraday's law. So since del cross is tantamount to multiplying with ik, so this will give me ik cross E equal to minus mu, and this is d by dt, and d by dt is multiplication by minus I omega. That takes care of this minus sign. So I'll be left with, after cancelling I from both sides, k cross u equal to k cross e is equal to mu omega h. And in the same fashion, the Ampere-Maxwell's relation del cross h equal to epsilon d by dt gives me, again, del cross is ik, so I get k cross h, that's equal to minus epsilon omega e. Del dot of E equal to 0, I k dot E equal to 0, which means k dot E equal to 0. Del dot of H equal to 0 gives me k dot of H equal to 0. So you notice, I have replaced my Maxwell's equations by, replaced all these differentials by equations which look like k cross E equal to mu omega H, k cross H equal to minus epsilon omega E, k dot E equal to 0, k dot H equal to 0. So this is my set of equations. Now you will agree that they are looking much less formidable than our original equations, because they are algebraic equations. Though with vectors, but they are algebraic equations. Now, firstly, you look at what statement that I can make. K cross E equal to H. I mean, forget about constant. Then K cross H is a minus E. Now, you see, in other words, H cross K would be E. So therefore, K, E, and H, they form a right-handed system. K cross E is H, E cross H in the direction of K, H cross E is in the direction of K. So K, E, and H in that order, or you want to remember it as E, H, and K, it doesn't matter. Secondly, this relationship tells me K is perpendicular to E, K dot E equal to 0. This relationship tells me not only K is perpendicular to E and K is perpendicular to H, the previous relation, it also tells me, both E and H are perpendicular to K. And because of the fact that K cross E is equal to H, I realize that I have a system where the direction of propagation, the electric field and the magnetic field are mutually perpendicular to each other. Now, this is something which is a characteristic of electromagnetic wave. Now, incidentally, I want to make it very clear, my discussion is only in vacuum. And so therefore, in the vacuum, why I am pointing this out is that though I won't have time to discuss this, when you teach fiber optics to your students, you will find that you differentiate between modes which are known as TE mode and TM mode. Transverse electric mode and transverse magnetic mode. There you say that if I take electric field perpendicular to a direction of propagation, okay, not worrying about what happens to the magnetic field, that is one type of a mode. Now the question always arises that if your fields are anyway always perpendicular, what is this classification that you are talking about? Point to realize is that these statements that I am making, that E, H, and K, E is perpendicular to H, and E and H are mutually perpendicular to a direction of propagation. These statements are valid only when light is traveling in vacuum. The moment you try to confine light, which is what we do in case of an optical fiber, for instance, or any other form of optical waveguide, then you have several other conditions to be met. We have discussed some, but this is not the place to talk about. For example, you know that the tangential component of the electric field must be discontinuous. And the normal component of the electric field must have a discontinuity if there are charges thereby. Now, these are the relations which govern things when you talk about a dielectric medium or a conducting medium or whatever you have. They are called waveguides. So this statement that I am making, very frequently made, electromagnetic waves are transverse. Very flip statement. The correct statement is electromagnetic waves are transverse when they are traveling in vacuum. Okay? If you have put a constraint on the electromagnetic waves, which is what you do by making it, forcing it to travel in a waveguide such as an optical fiber, this statement is no longer true. This is a point which is very frequently missed, but this is a point to be realized, that electromagnetic waves are transverse when they are traveling in vacuum. Okay, or in, of course, linear isotropic medium, which are basically infinite in extent. What you do in an optical fiber is to confine them. And when you confine them, you have additional constraints coming in at the interface between two medium, that you must have the tangential component of electric field continuous. Okay, so therefore, now the fields are now if you look, once you have made the statement, K is perpendicular to E, K is perpendicular to H, you can go back here. You can go back here and say that, well, in that case, H and E are simply related, that H is equal to epsilon omega by K from this equation, and which is your omega by K is nothing but the phase velocity of the medium, the velocity of light in that medium. So therefore, it is epsilon times U times C. Now, we had defined the refractive index as the ratio of the velocity of light in vacuum to the velocity of light in the medium. And that gives me, along with this equation, this is the refractive index N equal to C by U. You now translate this into a relationship between H and E. You get H is equal to N E divided by a quantity which is always represented by electrical engineers by Z naught. And Z naught is nothing but square root of mu by epsilon, or mu 0 by epsilon 0. This number is a very well-known number to all electrical engineers. This is called impedance of the free space and has a value very close to 377 ohms. So what we have said is that my electromagnetic field while traveling in vacuum is transverse. The K is the direction of propagation. Now, if K is perpendicular to E and H, the direction of K is that of E cross H. We did not have time to go through this, but the rate at which electromagnetic energy flows out of a surface of unit area, that is given by a quantity which is simply defined as E cross H. So E cross H is what is known as a pointing vector. Now, if we had time in the electromagnetic field course, then we would have shown that if you look at a electromagnetic field, you can talk about an energy density or an energy associated with a given volume. Now, this amount of energy is lost from a closed volume only in two ways. One is, of course, by mechanical work that it might have to do on charges or things like the etc. that might be there in the medium. And the second is just the radiation, the radiative flow of the electromagnetic energy. It simply goes out. Now, it is that quantity, the radiative flow per unit area, per unit time, is what is represented by the E cross H. That's called the pointing vector. Okay, so therefore, in fact, I have already shown it here, what I'm doing. See, if you took my cosine expression, all right, E is equal to E0 cos k dot r minus omega t, and H is equal to H0 cos k dot r minus omega t, then my S is given by E0 cross H0 times a cosine squared term. Okay, now if I did the corresponding exponential form, then I'll have to take a real part. Okay. Now, if you look at now, so you notice that this has a dependence on time as well. So if I am looking at a time average of the rate at which the energy flows out, then I need to take a time expectation value of this quantity. And because cosine square averaged over time has a value half, the expectation value of the pointing vector happens to be I k by k. Okay, the average value of pointing vector is also known as irradiance, and that is simply half E0 H0, which is given by this expression. Okay, let me come to another important aspect of electromagnetic waves, and that is what is known as the polarization. We had some discussion on polarization, but I will try to assure you that what we talked about last time was right. So we said that consider plane electromagnetic waves. By definition, when we say plane electromagnetic waves, the word plane means that surfaces of constant phase are planes. Yes.
Sir, in pointing vector, E cross H is there. Sir, can we still call it pointing vector if E and H are coming from a static field? Suppose E is perpendicular and H is also.
No. The point actually is this, that if everything is static, that's an incomplete situation, right? We have got these solutions only after we have got the full Maxwell's equation, written down a wave equation, okay? Solutions of the wave equation we received, and then we said, how does the energy vary with time? See, the question is, how can you talk about the pointing vector in a static case? Because the definition that I have given you is the rate at which the energy is flowing out of a unit area per unit time, okay? So if there is no time variation, none of this statement is correct. Okay, so let me take a plane electromagnetic wave. You could do the same calculation for example, spherical waves, but there the amplitudes will not be constant, but it will go as 1 over r. Now, suppose this is a complex expression. Now, the constant that is front of it, supposing this is a real quantity, and let us suppose that these are also constant. So if electric field is E0 exponential ik dot r minus I omega t, no dependence on r or t. If they are real constant vector, then the wave is plane polarized. Suppose you look at a particular time and look at the direction of the electric field at various points in space. We have said E0 and H0 are constant vectors. So if you are looking at freezing a particular time, you are looking at the different positions, then because of the fact E0 and H0 are constant, if you take a snapshot of various position, take a picture of various position at a given time, the directions of the electric field or magnetic field will be always contained in a plane. And because of that, this is called a plane polarized light. Alternatively, supposing you decide to look at the same point, but at different times, there are two ways of looking at the same situation. Either I can take a snapshot of what is happening to the electric field at a given time in all these positions. Then, since the electric vectors are parallel to each other, they all lie in a plane, and hence the name plane polarized. Alternatively, if I fix my attention at a particular position in space and look at what is happening to the electric field as time changes. Now, if time changes, because of the fact that there is this cosine factor there, but r is constant, the amount of the electric field that I have, the length, supposing I am representing them by a graph, the lengths of the electric vector will keep on changing. But their consecutive positions will always be along the same line. And because of this, the state of polarization is also called linear polarization. They're just two different terminologies, but coming from different statements, they're either called linear polarization or plane polarization. Plane polarization because at a given time and different points, the electric vectors are contained in a plane. Linear polarization because if I look at a particular point at different times, all the subsequent electric vectors always happen to be along the same line. This is a general picture of what happens for a plane polarized wave. Let us now change our situation a little bit and say that supposing I have two linearly polarized waves. Now remember, the principle of superposition is valid. So if I take two different solutions of a wave equation, add them up, whatever is the resulting wave, that is also a solution of the wave equation. Now because of that, if I take two waves, supposing one of them I take along, let us say, the x direction. The electric field is oriented along the x direction. Okay? The another wave which is oriented along the y direction. And not only that, the phase part of it, one of the waves has a cosine and the other one is sine, meaning thereby there is a phase difference of pi by 2 between them. So if I add them up, because of the fact I have taken the amplitudes to be the same, one of them is along the x direction, another of them is along the y direction, the addition of these will give me a vector whose tip is going to describe a circle, because of the simple reason that cosine square plus sine square equal to 1. And this direction of the circle with different time would depend upon which one is chosen as cosine, which one is chosen as sine. So I can either have a circle where the electric vector is moving in an anti-clockwise fashion or in a clockwise fashion. So corresponding to that, I have what is called as the right circularly polarized wave or a left circularly polarized wave. So this is circular polarization. The elliptic polarization is very much similar. I still have the same type of representation, excepting that what I do is, instead of the constant here being the same in both the waves, I take them to be different, in which case the tip of the electric vector will describe an ellipse. Okay? This is the picture of what happens to a circular polarization, for instance. So what is happening is, there is this direction k in which it is progressing, but if you are looking at the tip of the electric vector at a particular point in space, now what it is doing is to describe a circle. Let us come back to the question of what happens when an electromagnetic wave is incident at the plane boundary between two different dielectrics, for example air and glass, which is the most common example. Now you all of course know what are the law of reflection and refraction. So the point is that how does one understand it from electromagnetic theory? So I have an interface here which is perpendicular to the plane of the screen, and I have an incident ray, I have a reflected ray and a transmitted ray. So let me make the following statement. Supposing the electric field, the space-time dependence of the vectors are given by this. Only I have not written the amplitude, I have simply said that this is given by I k dot r minus omega t, which is the incident wave, I k prime dot r minus omega t, which is the reflected wave, and I k double prime dot r minus omega t, which is the transmitted wave. Now, what I want is that when they come to the phase, so to the boundary interface, at all points on the boundary and at all times, I must have a constant relationship which must exist between them. Irrespective of what happens, whatever is the magnitude, in order that that constant relationship doesn't change, the argument of the exponential function must be the same at all times on the boundary. So I need k dot r equal to k prime dot r equal to k double prime dot r. Now, using this, I have assumed that k is the incident wave vector, k prime is the reflected wave vector, k double prime is the transmitted wave, the refracted wave vector, same thing as transmitted wave vector. Now, I can now decide on my coordinate system. So the coordinate system, remember I have this relationship, k dot r equal to k prime dot r equal to k double prime dot r at every point.
Basically, the confusion in the transmitted ray and the refracted ray is this.
Yeah.
In the instruments which measure the transmittance and the refractance, they measure the intensity which is transmitted out of the media itself.
That's what I said. You are talking about an emergent ray then.
Yeah. So emergent ray, the transmittance is measured in the terms of emergent ray intensity itself.
Absolutely. But
that's why there is a confusion.
So there are two interfaces there. The first interface is on the first slab of the glass, and second interface is inside the second medium when it again meets a boundary between air and the glass.
Yeah, definitely. So intensity is going to reduce.
Yeah.
The refracted ray is going to be more intense.
But you see, what we are talking about is at one interface.
Okay.
Okay. I'm not talking about what happens to the future of that ray.
No, but I am telling that transmittance definition itself is having some error in that sense.
In optics, there is no confusion. If you are talking about the interface between two media, the first medium is called incident medium. The second medium is called transmitting medium, not refracted. The phenomena is called refraction. Transmission is what is transmitted to another medium. Okay?
Yes.
Now, what the confusion is, which he has partly corrected, is most of the time when you are doing an experiment in a lab, you are not going to have an infinite slab. You have a slab of finite dimension. So actually, in that case, you have two refractions. One at the interface of air and the first glass, then that ray goes and hits the bottom of that glass and goes out again. Okay? In most optics book, they will call the first one as the incident ray, second one as the refracted ray, the third one as the emergent or a transmitted ray.
Sir, in the measurements, transmitted ray and emergent ray are treated to be same. When the angle of incidence is, it means it is normal incidence.
No, but we are not talking about necessarily about normal incidence, okay?
It means in the measurements,
we introduce the sample normally. We are just wasting time on what I call as the English language problem rather than physics problem. I am sure all of you understand it, okay? What I am trying to tell you is the standard language followed in any optics books. I also understand the language that you are talking about because I have also gone through the same school books, okay? What I am trying to tell you is that if I take this as a medium, when a ray came here, that is incident ray. When it is inside water, it is, you would call it refracted ray. I would call it transmitted ray because my water amount is infinity. It's not coming out. On the other hand, you would call that a refracted ray, and since it is going to come out, you will call that a transmitted ray. That's all. But I have said that time and again that I am using what is normally used in any book of optics, any book you can see. You have a reflection.
Reflection.
Refraction word is for the phenomena, not ever for the wave, not for the ray. Okay?
Goes into the medium that is transmitted.
The one which goes into the second medium is a transmitted. Clear? Okay? Let's not waste more time on the language. Okay. So, After we have agreed that we will take my understanding of the nomenclature as the standard for this class, let us do the following. So what we said is this, that I got a relationship of this type, that in order that there is a constant phase relationship, k dot r equal to k prime dot r equal to k double prime dot r. Now notice that this tells me that the vectors k, remember that r is any point on the interface. Okay. Now, it tells me the vectors k, k prime and k double prime are coplanar. Okay. And their projection on the boundary have to be equal because k dot r is the projection on the boundary. This is the basic physics there. Now, suppose I take the k to lie in xy plane. Right? Supposing I take k to lie in the xy plane, then k prime and k double prime will also lie in the same plane. Because k dot r equal to k prime dot r equal to k double prime dot r. Now, so as a result now, with this choice, and because of the fact that k dot r is the same, I can choose my coordinate axis properly and see that k sine theta is k prime sine theta prime. Remember, theta prime is my angle of refraction and the angle of transmittance is phi and equal to k double prime sine phi. This simply comes from k dot r equal to k prime dot r equal to k double prime dot r. So that immediately tells me that if I am looking in the first medium, remember the reflected ray is always in the same medium. So as a result, the magnitude of k and k prime are the same. So if magnitude of k and k prime are the same, where the wave number is the same, then this will tell me sin theta equal to sin theta prime means theta equal to theta prime. That is nothing but the law of reflection. Then again, if I look at what is my k ratio of k double prime to k, I know that is the ratio is omega by the velocity in that medium to omega by velocity in this medium, and that is equal to the velocity in this medium to the velocity in that medium, which is nothing but the refractive index. And that is where you got that sine phi by sine theta is the refractive index of the second medium with respect to the first medium. Okay, that's your Snell's law. So the thing is this, that I've got the following situation. I have said that for the incident ray, I have h equal to k cross e. For the reflected ray, I've got h prime equal to k prime cross e prime. I've got h double prime, k double prime cross e double prime, that's for the transmitted. Now, what is done is that we are interested in finding out what fraction of electromagnetic wave or electromagnetic energy, if you like, is transmitted into the second medium, how much is reflected back and things like that. Now, this is very important from technical point of view, I'll tell you a little later. But in order to do that, what is done conventionally is to divide the solution into two parts. Say that you talk about what is known as a TE polarization. The TE modes, the electric vectors of the incident wave is taken to be perpendicular to the plane of polarization. And in the TM mode, the magnetic vector is taken to be perpendicular to the plane of polarization. But let me just talk about just the TE, and what I want to get is the ratio of the amplitudes of the electric field or magnetic field, it doesn't matter, of the reflected part and the incident part. So let us look at that. I will not do the derivation, but it's fairly straightforward. See, the point is this. Now I have said that my light is going into a second medium. In other words, it has met with a boundary. Now, when electric field is incident on a boundary, there are two conditions to be met. I need to say, remember I talked about electrostatic boundary condition, and we said the tangential component of the electric field must always be continuous. It is that continuity which is what helps us in determining these ratios. So look at what it means. So I say that this is the way I would write down. I have said that tangential component of the electric field is continuous, which means E plus E prime equal to E double prime. Now I know that the magnetic fields H, H prime, H double prime are proportional to this. So I can write down E plus E prime equal to E double prime in terms of the corresponding fields and the angles. Now I will not do this arithmetic, but if you do that, you find a ratio of E prime by E corresponding to the TE polarization here, and this is the expression for the TM polarization. So this is simply telling you what is the ratio of the amplitudes of the, these are known as Fresnel equations. I'm not going to derive it here, they're in any textbook, but you can see how the derivation is entirely based on saying that the tangential component of electric field is continuous. Having done that, here the S is for TE polarization, P is for the TM polarization. You can show, these are known as the Fresnel equation, E prime by E is given by such an expression. And the reflectance, which is defined as the square of this, is E prime by E whole square. And for example, if you want to take normal incidence, then you will have theta equal to 0, which will leave us with that the reflectance for both the types is n minus 1 by n plus 1 whole square. What does it actually tell? It says that if you are in normal incidence, I still have certain amount of field which is reflected. Now notice that I have not talked about any losses or any such thing. It is just because of the fact that something is incident on a surface. You cannot avoid reflection altogether. Now this problem, this tells me that if you take, for example, glass with a refractive index of 1.5, It tells you that there is a minimum reflection of 4%, because if you calculate n minus 1 whole square by n plus 1 whole square, that's what you get. Now, this is rather important, particularly in optical instruments like, for example, camera, which may have a large number of lenses. And at every lens, you will have a reflection. And even though they are just 4% reflections, these reflections can add up to a significant amount. Okay? So there will be a light loss at every time. So what they do to avoid such things in cameras is to coat the lenses with anti-reflection coatings. Okay. Now, there are many other interesting things about the Fresnel equations. So let us go back, take any of these expressions. See, it had this, let's take just the TE polarizer, cos theta minus square root of n square minus sine square theta. Remember, what is n? N is the refractive index of the second medium with respect to the first medium. I just have two medium, I don't have a third medium, okay? Now notice, if it happens that sine theta is greater than n, now obviously, I am talking about a situation where the refractive index of the second medium is less than the refractive index of the first medium, okay? So if it happens that n is less than sine theta, then at that angle, the square root, the argument of the square root would become negative. Now, if the square root argument becomes negative, I will be able to write the reflection coefficient as cos theta by interchanging the sine theta and n in this expression as cos theta minus I times square root of that, cos theta plus I times square root of that. Now, notice that the numerator and the denominator of these expressions are complex conjugate of each other. As a result, the absolute value of that is equal to 1. What it tells me is that in such a case, the entire field is reflected back into the medium. And because of that, this phenomena is known as the total internal reflection. It goes back into the medium. Okay, this is something which is known to you. But though the incident energy is totally reflected back into the first medium, the field in the second medium is not zero. There is a field close to the interface into the second medium. That is, the field leaks into the second medium. I'll show you how. And this field is known as an evanescent field. Okay? Its behavior is a little interesting. Look at what we are saying regarding the electric vector of the transmitted wave. So we had this expression there. Okay? Transmitted wave is e double prime e to the power I k double prime dot r, etc. And I have written what is k double prime dot r in terms of the angle of refraction. You do this, you find that the sine cosine of the refraction angle is imaginary. So therefore, the electric vector actually becomes like this. So there is a part which is moving along the interface with the cosine or sine that you have taken. But as you go away from interface, the field exponentially decreases. Okay? Now let me summarize what I said. I said that when, though I am showing it in a medium where I am going from air to a denser medium, the actual question that I am discussing is the light is coming from a denser medium to a rarer medium, okay? And it is falling on an interface at an angle greater than the critical angle for that medium. You know that when light is incident at an angle greater than critical angle, the light is totally reflected, which comes out from the Fresnel equation. Because we have shown just now that the magnitude is equal to 1. Now, though it is totally reflected, the total energy is totally reflected, the field just outside the interface is not equal to 0. This is called an evanescent wave. It is not equal to 0, but it propagates on the surface. But if you go away from the surface, its amplitude decreases exponentially. So therefore, there is really not a great deal of leakage into the second medium. Though it is rather an exponentially decaying thing, but one can actually detect it by putting a detection mechanism very close to the interface. So these are evanescent waves. Okay. So let me, since we have just talked about total internal reflection, let me use this opportunity of talking to you about what is known as the acceptance angle of a waveguide. Now, since all of you have been worried about that I need more mediums, so I have here a medium which such as air. Now, this is a refractive index N1, which is the core of the fiber, and on this is jacketed by a cladding. And what we have is this N1 is slightly greater than N2. Typical numbers are 1.48, 1.46. It's not a very much difference. Okay? And of course, you have air. Now, what happens is this, that, okay, go back to this picture. So, what happens is that if light is incident at, you know, supposing I have a point source of light symmetrically placed. Now, what are the two extreme rays, okay, which defines my region over which the light can be incident on the fiber optic waveguide such that it is guided inside. Now, what is meant by guided inside? We know that in case of fiber optic waveguide, the general guidance is along the length of the fiber, which let's call it as the Z direction, but it doesn't mean it is traveling along the axis. What it could be doing is to go to the, make an angle, go to the interface between the core and the cladding, and since the index of refraction of the core is slightly greater than that of the cladding, depending upon the critical angle of the medium, yes, it will get totally reflected. Come back again, go to the other face, and it keeps on doing this, but on an average, it starts moving along the direction. So what we say is this, supposing I is the angle of incidence. Remember, the angle of incidence is not this angle. The angle of incidence is the angle which the normal to the interface. So supposing this is the direction. So I have a ray which is falling like this. The angle of incidence will be, I have to take a perpendicular on that interface, and that is my angle of incidence I. Okay? The angle of refraction, which you normally call, is then sin I by sin theta. I is in the air medium. Theta is in the denser medium, but there are two denser mediums there. But theta is in core. It has to fall on the core. So sin I by sin theta is N1 by N2. Let's say N1 is the refractive index of air, which we'll later on take to be equal to 1, and N2 is the refractive index of the core. Okay. Now, I know that for total reflection to take place, my incident angle at the top, see what is happening is, you have to imagine, unfortunately I don't have that picture. See, the thing is this, that you have a refraction, correct? Now, this ray is now going and falling on the core cladding boundary. So, draw a normal there. Now, that angle at which it has fallen there is what I am calling as phi. But that phi obviously is 90 minus theta. Clear? The geometry is clear. That is the only thing that I wanted. So, therefore, my sine phi is same as cos theta. And this sin phi or the cos theta, if it is greater than N2 by N1, right? Now I have N0, N1 and N2. If it is greater than N2 by N1, then I have a critical reflection. Is it clear? Because N2 by N1 is the relative refractive index. Now the point is this, that if you look at this relation then, it tells me my sin theta should be less than root of 1 minus n2 square by this thing, and then you do a trivial arithmetic, it works out to n1 square minus n2 square by n0 square. And you take n0 to be equal to 1 traditionally. So therefore, it tells me that assuming n0 is equal to 1, the maximum value of the incident angle, okay? Once incident angle is decided, you can also decide what is the aperture here. Angle at which a total reflection will take place at the core cladding boundary is sine of I maximum is equal to square root of n1 square minus n2 square. Okay? So this maximum angle, say anything falling with an angle less than that, the light will be guided. Clear? It will not be guided, it will be not be totally reflected if this condition is not met. So in some sense, IM, the maximum value of the incident angle, is a measure of the light gathering power. That this is the light which is gathered together so that the it can be sent through a fiber.
Means can I say like this, sir, that if the angle of incidence is equal to acceptance angle at that time, phi becomes phi c and the total internal reflection taken place?
See, the what I have defined is what is known as a numerical aperture at this moment. But basically, I have talked about in terms of the incident angle. Now, if you are looking at a light cone, you see, I have a point source. From point source, various lines go out, right? There would be a solid angle at that point, okay, which you can easily calculate. From there, if the rays come out and hit the air fiber boundary at an angle less than IM, then the guidance is possible. Is this clear? So this is what it is. There is actually, if another relation is there, it's equal to 1. So this numerical aperture is defined to be a measure of the light gathering power of the at the fiber end, okay, which is given by square root of n1 square minus n2 square. Now if you take the 1.48 and 1.46, the typical values of the fiber, then you find that it is about 14 degrees. In other words, the maximum angle of incidence, it's a very narrow beam, it should be, and that's why you want a laser source or things like that, okay, then only it will go. But we'll come back to discussion of fiber a little later in the second session. So I will now spend the rest of the 10-15 minutes that I have in discussing the linear superposition and interference. I'm not discussing the standard Young's double slit experiment or diffraction or things like that. I'm just going through the principle of it. Very interesting things come out of here. Firstly, let us consider two plane harmonic waves which are linearly polarized. Okay? Let the first one, now you know I have used a very funny nomenclature, E with a subscript 1 within its bracket is E1 times the exponential I k1 dot r minus omega t plus phi 1. The second electric field I have taken is E2. So there is a difference between this E1 and this E1 within bracket, that is one of them is multiplied with its phase factor, the other one is not. Okay? Now, we define irradiances at a point as the square of the amplitude of the light field. And I know that the superposition principle is valid. So if I have two waves E1 and E2, okay, then my irradiance would be given by E1 plus E2 absolute square. Now I have taken exponential form, so I have to be a little more careful. So my I is E dot E star, because I need real part only. And that is E1 plus E2 dot E1 plus E2, and you just multiply them, you get E1 square plus E2 square plus 2 E1 dot E2 times cos theta, where theta is defined by this. Now notice, E1 and E2 cos E1 dot E2 cos theta. It is not E1 into E2 into cos theta, because the cos theta has come from the cosine part. I have electric vector which I am multiplying. This, if you look at it, has a E1 square which is my I1, E2 square which is my I2, and this is the interference term that I have. It's an interesting point. There are very many things that come out of that interference problem. Only a part of it is explained in the school. First thing that you realize is this, that my irradiance is given by 2 E1 dot E2 times cos theta, where theta is K1 dot R minus K2 dot R plus phi 1 minus phi 2. Look at this, depending upon whether this term is greater than or less than 0, the net intensity that I get at a point could be greater than or less than the sum of the intensities due to a single thing. That of course you know, okay? So this is the reason why you get familiar fringes, okay? The second point is, suppose I take the sources to be mutually, okay, incoherent, meaning thereby the two waves that you have taken, they have a phase factor phi 1 and phi 2 which are random. Now if that happens, then the cos theta which has phi 1 minus phi 2, it is randomly varying and as a result its average is 0. So therefore I will not have any interference. So incoherent waves, the waves which have no definite phase relationship between the two waves, they do not contribute to the interference term. The third point is this, supposing the two waves are differently polarized, then E1 dot E2 factor will also be different. Normally when we do this calculation in school or college, we assume that the direction of polarization of E1 is the same as the direction of polarization of E2, so that this expression is always written as E1 times E2. But what comes out of the vector addition is not E1 times A2, but E1 vector dotted with E2 vector, where E1 is the amplitude part of it, okay, along with the direction. Now in particular, if E1 and E2 are orthogonally polarized, perpendicularly polarized, then E1 dot E2 is by definition 0. Now since that term becomes 0, it tells you that you cannot have interference between two waves whose polarizations are perpendicular. This is not only true for linear polarized wave, you cannot have interference between two circularly polarized light if one of them has a left-handed polarization and the other one has a right-handed polarization. The experiments are very easy to perform actually. You do interference experiments in your this thing labs, and frequently near one of the slits you put a small mica. They say let us determine the thickness, right? A standard experiment done. Why? Because light in moving through the mica travels an extra distance. So there is an additional phase difference which depends upon the thickness through which it has gone. Now supposing you were to put in any other phase giving thing there, you first polarize them, then as I was talking to you yesterday, supposing you decide to put a quarter wave plate there so that one of them has an additional phase there, then when you add, you have to put this additional phase also. And if you manage to give a full half wave between the two, okay, then you are also having something else. But suppose I now put in polarizers there so that the two waves that you have got are differently polarized, then you will find there will be uniform illumination on the. So what you have said is incoherent waves do not give us interference pattern. That's number one. The polarized, now mostly what we have is you get an interference pattern with the light that comes in, because they, even when they have the polarization in similar direction, there will always be a component in the same direction, because you are never able to perfectly make them in orthogonal polarization. Okay, in the second session, I will be discussing some properties of the optical fiber. This will be again a hurried session. Yes.
You talked about this evanescent wave.
Evanescent wave.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But this is related to the case when you have this total internal reflection.
Yes. Yes.
And you said that the energy is actually completely get reflected. So, but you, there is a still a bit of kind of leakage outside the
signal is there.
Signal is there. So is this really like this quantum mechanical tunneling kind of
this is basically classical tunneling.
Classical, it looks like actually.
Where the field is there. But you remember, if such a evanescent wave was not there, you will never be able to couple a fiber optic to an outside cable. Okay? Well, okay, let's come back to it again.
Okay, so.
Second session, remind me that question, we'll talk.
Okay. Yesterday we had a discussion about equivalence of the electric field and the magnetic field that you talked about. But if today obviously you showed these two equations which are completely identical, but if electric field and magnetic field were really truly identical or equivalent to each other, then instead of having H, I should have an equation in terms of B, but instead of B, I have an equation with H. So I cannot really say that probably that they are not truly equivalent. That's my...
I said that the equations that they satisfy is identical. Okay? So therefore...
No, the identical equations are being satisfied by H and not B.
B also satisfies similar equation with the constants being different. That's all.
Yeah. Okay.
You can write down that also. Mm-hmm. The same constants will come there. Because I have talked about here of a linear isotropic medium. So H, wherever H is there, write B by mu zero and cancel out it from
Yeah.
Equation is the same.
Okay.
How will the equation will not change?
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Okay.